It's the sport's most prestigious event, the GEICO PBA World Series of Bowling. 240 pros from 20 countries are here in Las Vegas, among them the PBA's best, all competing for the multiple championships that are up for grabs. It's professional bowling's ultimate test, and it's next on ESPN. Las Vegas, GEICO PBA World Series of Bowling 6 rolls on at South Point Bowling Plaza. The international stars of men's and women's professional bowling meet and compete in a new match play scoring system to determine two World Bowling Tour champions. Top three players in the women's division will compete first, followed by our men's division to determine a World Bowling Tour champion. And hello again, everyone. Mike Jakubowski with PBA Hall of Famer Randy Peterson. Randy, in 2011, World Bowling and the Professional Bowlers Association teamed up to create the World Bowling Tour and a two-year rolling point system where the top three compete annually, and we have that here today, beginning with our women.
We have some great talent on the telecast today, and the opening match on the women's side will feature Sandra Andersson from Sweden, who finished second, runner-up to Carolyn Doran Ballard in 2011 in the inaugural WBT event. She's going to be taking on Liz Johnson, and Liz Johnson's resume is very long and distinguished. She's the owner of five major championship victories, but the road to victory on the women's side will have to travel through arguably the greatest women bowler on the planet today, and that's Kelly Kulick.
And on the men's side, Randy, perhaps the hottest rivalry in PBA history begins.
Not perhaps, it is. Jason Belmonte and Sean Rash. I mean, if you're a bowling fan, this is the one match that you stay up late for. The last time we saw these two go at it was at the Super Clash in Detroit, and Jason Belmonte was all over Sean Rash and came away with that victory. Waiting for the winner of that opening match will be this man, Mika Koivuniemi. He's the number one seed because he's been the most consistent globally for the last two seasons.
So Belmonte and Rash will square off in the first of the two men's matches, and the winner will advance to meet Koivuniemi, who appears in these WBT finals for the fourth straight time. We begin with our women's competition first. Sweden, Sandra Andersson versus Liz Johnson, who is standing by with Kimberly Pressler.
Thanks, guys. Liz, this is the third consecutive year that you've been in the finals for this event. You've got a third place and a second place. What do you got to do to take the first place today?
Well, this is a little different format this year, and I just got to, you know, it's just got to keep striking. You got to make a lot of strikes and hopefully get to the finals.
Well, good luck to you today. Guys, back to you in the booth.
Thanks, Kimberly. South Point Bowling Plaza here in Las Vegas. And Randy, it's a brand new scoring system called Frame Play being tested here, and each match consists of 12 frames. In each frame, each player will throw a shot. Player with the highest pin count wins the frame. If both players strike, the frame will be tied. If neither player strikes in the frame, but have the same pin count, then we shoot spares.
Think about it, kind of like watching the Ryder Cup. If a bowler wins the first frame, that player's one up. And once that a player is up more than there are frames left, the match, or the game rather, is over.
Again, this is a bit of an experiment by the WBT, and it'll be interesting to see how it works. 12 frames of competition. Should it go that far? Here's our first look at Liz Johnson out of Cheektowaga, New York.
Wow,
7-pin.
She's not real happy with that. That's stone 7. Pin went right over the top of the 7-pin. She gets 9. Sandra, if she gets 9, both players would then step up and shoot the spares. If Sandra gets a strike, she will be one up in the match after one frame.
A from Ängelholm, Sweden, Sandra Andersson, 23 years old. Member of Team Sweden since 2010. A strike and she'll capture the frame in frame play. A 9 and the frame will be halved, an 8 and Johnson will take the frame. Opening shot. And a strike for Sandra Andersson, and Andersson takes frame 1.
Liz Johnson's shot was actually better and she ends up losing the frame.
So now Andersson will cross over.
Check out this oil pattern, folks, 47 feet in length. It's called the Paris pattern. It's been utilized in select WBT events this season and is the longest of their patterns. It is USB-C sport compliant, features a lower volume of oil and a narrow shape.
Andersson one up in this match on the left lane. And she packs a strike, Sandra Andersson. Strikes in her opening shots.
Young Sandra, not intimidated by the likes of Liz Johnson, just steps up and goes pack, pack.
So now Johnson must strike to have the frame and remain one down. Liz, 40 years old, 10-time Team USA member. And the 10 pin falls, and the frame is halved.
Little love tap on the 10. And Liz Johnson feels a little redemption after the solid 7 that she left in the first frame. Those eyes focusing down low on the floor. And she's hoping for a little love tap and gets it from the 6 pin.
So Andersson remains one up. Liz, I mentioned, is 40. She says she feels like 25. She sticks to her diet and exercise regimen, and she feels she's as in good a shape as when she was 25. And Johnson on the board with a strike.
Liz going with two different bowling balls.
Two shots before
early on.
I did the same thing.
Last
same
three line. Shots, all nice in the pocket. Sandra Andersson. Sweden, member of Team Sweden since 2010. She's got some game. Watched her practice the other night here, and she rolls it really, really nice.
And the 4-pin, and Johnson earns the frame, and the match is all square.
Remember, 12 frames in this game.
As we mentioned, our three women's finalists made it here today by finishing 2014 at the top of the World Bowling Tour two-year rolling points list. Kelly Kulick squarely at number 1 with 718 points, followed by Johnson and Andersson. Andersson back up here in the 4th. The match is all square. Tight on the head pivot, trips the 4, Andersson.
You can just see how long this oil pattern is. I mean, the balls aren't even curving on the left lane. And the last couple of shots that, especially the first shot that Liz Johnson left the solid 7, I thought that she had missed way left of target. And I mean, this ball just, it's fading as it gets to the head pin. 47 feet, extremely long. I'd rather see more ball motion down the lane.
Johnson up, must strike to have the frame. And the 4-pin wiggles, but doesn't go down. Andersson picks up the frame and goes to one up on the event.
Again, a little bit high, doesn't get the trip on the 4-pin on that right lane. Sandra Andersson one up after 4. Liz Johnson now moves over to the left lane, changes bowling balls. Looking to even this match. with a strike here in the fifth.
It's the frame play scoring system. Win the frame is the name of the game.
Look out.
4-9. So that's an 8 count. And an interesting thing here, Randy, perhaps or if Sandra Andersson were to leave the 4-7, they would shoot the spares.
Correct. Just pretty straight up 13-14. Just a little bit tighter than she wanted. 4-9 split. Sandra Andersson, if she gets 9, she'll go 2 up in this match.
And a strike for Andersson, so taking advantage and going up. 2 up now with a win of the frame. Frame play in effect here at the World Bowling Tour Women's Finals. Our first match continues when we return to South Point. Sandra Andersson is 2 up. Can Liz Johnson find a way to even things up? And we'll see how deep this match goes. More coming from Vegas. The GEICO World Series of Bowling World Bowling Tour Finals, presented by the PBA, is brought to you by GEICO, saving people money on more than just car insurance. By AMF, roll this way. By Barbasol, life is full of close shaves. Make sure your close shave is a Barbasol close shave. And by Track Bowling, make the smart move. Sandra Andersson 2 up over Liz Johnson through 5 frames. World Bowling Tour Women's Finals using frame play, match play style, where each player throws the first ball and the goal is to win the frame. Liz Johnson is 2 down and Sandra Andersson will get the first crack here in the 6th frame. 12 frames are a match, and if you can be up more than frames remaining, you win the match. Winner gets Kelly Kulick in the final. Third arrow. And another strike for Sandra Andersson, lined up.
She's flushed every shot. The only frame that she didn't strike in was the third, where she left the four pin. Keeps the pressure on Liz Johnson. Liz, here in the 6th frame, does not want to fall 3 back. 6 frames remaining.
Andersson applying the pressure, and Liz must answer. And great Liz shot. Does answer.
Great shot for Liz Johnson there. As we take a look at her arsenal, using the IQ Nano, excuse me, the IQ Tour Nano on the right lane, Crux on the left lane.
Johnson down 2, 7th frame. Now with her first shot in the 7th. And set the mark for Andersson. Mixing now, 5-7 split.
Got it just a pinch to the right. Not a very good break. She could have mixed up one of those pins and just left maybe a 5-pin or a 7-pin. Instead, it's the 5-7. Sandra Andersson can now increase her lead to go 3 up, 5 frames remaining.
And the 8 and the 10 get kicked out, and that is a strike for Andersson, and she earns the frame. She's plus 3 now, 3 up after 7 with 5 to play.
Sandra's arsenal, sinister. Both players using aggressive equipment, obviously with a 47-foot pattern. Sandra Andersson, 3 up, 5 frames remaining. She struck every shot except the third. Neither player has missed the pocket yet through seven frames.
And a solid forepin.
And a chance for Liz Johnson to get back into this.
Johnson can strike here. Go to two down and then have the first shot next frame.
Pretty good looking shot here. And just that little bit of reaction down lane as it enters the pocket to creep up just a pinch high. She sits next to her tour rep, Chris Schlemmer.
And Liz gets the strike.
And two almost identical hits for both players. Liz trips the four. Sandra doesn't. Liz cuts it down to a two-up match for Sandra Andersson. Four frames to play. Sandra two up. Liz Johnson is now going to stay with the same ball she's using on the right lane. She's going to throw it on the left lane. Good toss and a good adjustment and a nice ball change on the left.
That wasn't striking. That was an eight pin or something.
Sandra Andersson now in a must strike situation to maintain a two up advantage. Sandra is a certified pro shop operator and a makeup artist. Hopefully she doesn't mix up her brushes with her Aberlot pads. Ninth frame. Good shot. Strike halves the frame and maintains a two-up advantage.
She's been labeling every shot. Just a couple of four pins. Well, let's see if she strikes here. The worst she can do is go dormy in the match. Because if Liz were to tie her, Sandra would be two up with two frames to play.
And then we would roll on with additional frames. First shot in the 10th, Sandra Andersson.
Wow. What a performance. Boy, she throwing it great. I mean, all over Liz Johnson. Liz Johnson, she's got to feel like there's an elephant sitting on her chest right now. She's getting no breathing room from Sandra Andersson whatsoever.
I moved on that one, too.
If she doesn't strike on this shot, the match is over.
And strike for Johnson to stay alive.
Well, another nice shot by Liz. Gives her a little bit of life. Sandra Andersson two up, two frames to play. Liz isn't going to go away without a fight.
Liz Johnson won a European Bowling Tour title in Odense, Denmark in June of 2014. An all-women's final on the EBT, defeating Mai Jensen of Denmark in that title match. Down two with two to play. Must win this frame. And a trip four.
Well, see what Sandra has. If Sandra strikes on this ball, the match is over.
Two up with one to play would be a winner. And Sandra Andersson looking to advance to face Kelly Kulick in our Women's World Bowling Tour final. Strike to advance. Eight 10 split, and now just one up with one to play.
Andersson is one up with one frame to go.
Well, she is back in the same position. If she strikes on the next ball, she still wins. Put that behind you, forget about the 8-10. She's on what I think is the better of the two lanes. Strike here and it's all over. The best Liz Johnson could do would be to tie, and Sandra would finish one up after 12 frames. Strike to win.
That's wide off her hand.
We have a whole new ball game. You got to pencil Liz Johnson in right now at getting more than six. We're going to go into extra frames.
Johnson wins the frame. It would be an even match, and we roll on. Keep bowling frames until we have a winner. Johnson, seven, will extend this match or better.
That's a winner.
Liz Johnson coming from three down to even things up after 12, and we will go extra frames.
That's a great shot by a great champion who has now extended this match.
And Liz Johnson will get the left lane, and we go bonus frames, frame play, match play, and we go extra frames. All square through 12.
Now it's just matching your opponent shot for shot. Liz Johnson strikes. Sandra Andersson gets nine. Sandra will be eliminated.
Couple chances to eliminate Johnson. And Johnson is still alive. Here we go, 13th frame. Great champions throw great shots when they need to.
They persevere, and that's what Liz Johnson did. She was at one point three down in the match. She hung in there, never gave up. She was three down after seven frames. And then got an opening. This ball has to be a strike by Sandra Andersson, or it's all over. Just a couple of frames ago, all she had to do was strike to move on.
Four-pin stands. Liz Johnson survives and advances to face Kelly Kulick.
Right now, Sandra is in shock that she lost this match. And quite frankly, so am I. She never missed a pocket the entire game, and the one shot she needed the most absolutely threw it right out of the window.
Liz Johnson will face Kelly Kulick, and Liz hangs on and goes extra to get to our championship match. More from Vegas coming your way next. And welcome back to South Point Bowling Plaza in Las Vegas, Nevada, getting set for our World Bowling Tour Women's Final. As Liz Johnson defeats Sandra Andersson, final one up after bonus frames. Coming up next week, a Super Bowl Sunday tradition. It's the CP3 PBA Celebrity Invitational. Joining NBA superstar Chris Paul will be a host of PBA Pros, along with celebrities like Nick Cannon, NFL legend Terrell Owens, rapper French Montana, actor Jesse Williams, and comedian Chris Hardwick. Don't miss out on the fun next Sunday at 4:30 Eastern, right here on ESPN. And our highlights from our first look at frame play, Randy.
And Sandra Andersson was just absolutely bearing the pocket. She steps up in the 11th frame, leaves an 8-10, gives a little bit of life left to Liz Johnson. All she had to do, though, was strike on her last shot. Instead, she goes washout. Liz Johnson has to strike to even the match. She does that on the 12th shot. We go to extra frames. In the 13th frame, Liz Johnson gets up first. She goes high flush for 10 in the pit. Sandra Andersson steps up. and she goes high, a little too high, doesn't trip the four, and her day is done.
And Randy, it's the perseverance of Liz Johnson. She was down three, and she finds a way to win.
Well, I mean, that's what great champions do. You know, traditional scoring, I think if you look back at the scoreboard, Sandra Andersson wins this match. And that's even if you give Liz Johnson one of the two split conversions. But in this scoring system, Liz Johnson hung in there. When she got the opening, she took advantage of it and threw great strikes down the stretch.
And a comeback with the new frame play that we haven't seen before using traditional bowling scoring. A very, very interesting application. And now Randy Peterson examines the sport of bowling from the approach through the pin deck in this accelerating Track Tech Talk.
I'm often asked by amateurs, Randy, what is the correct way to create ball speed? What I see most from amateurs, they try to do it with just their arm. They never use their lower body. Today we're going to talk about how to get your lower body involved. Take a page out of Tommy Jones's handbook. Get the ball into the swing early. This makes the feet run faster, and this creates ball speed. So there you have it. Get the ball into the swing sooner and much quicker, and voila, instant ball speed.
Liz Johnson will advance to the Women's World Bowling Tour Finals and face Kelly Kulick when we return to South Point Bowling Plaza in Vegas. Stay with us. South Point Bowling Plaza, host of Geico PBA World Series of Bowling 6 television finals, including the World Bowling Tour Finals, where we find Liz Johnson getting set to face Kelly Kulick in our women's final.
Well, here's a highlight from last year with Kelly Kulick. Basically just was a striking beast, taking down Missy Parkin en route to capturing the WBT Women's Finals.
Kimberly Pressler is with Kelly Kulick. Kimberly.
Thanks, Mike. Kelly, you are the defending champion. What would it mean to you to get back-to-back wins?
Oh, huge feather in my cap. You know, it's been a grind all year long. We don't have many opportunities for the ladies to bowl in. I have had the opportunity to defend my title and try to do it. I've never done it before. So now is more than ever my opportunity to go back-to-back.
I wish you luck today. Guys, back to you in the booth.
Well, you're looking at arguably the greatest woman bowler on the planet today, and she said it would be the, you know, another feather in her cap to successfully defend a title. See if she can get it done. I'll tell you one thing: this oil pattern very conducive to the way Kelly Kulick throws it, and I say that because she likes to slow roll it.
Kelly Kulick, 37, out of Union, New Jersey.
10-time member of Team USA. That's like being a 10-time All-Star, if you will.
Bowling in the match play style, they call frame play. Opening shot is a 10 pin. That's a 9 count in frame play. The object is to win the frame, 12 frames in a game. And when you have an advantage greater than the frames remaining, you win the match. And Liz Johnson took advantage in the semifinal, coming back to defeat Sandra Andersson in 13. And that's an 8 count, and Kulick earns the frame. So Kelly goes up 1-0.
A little slow.
Well, you heard Liz say she got a little slow, and it looked like she got it a little right. The ball hit the lane and hooked immediately. Watch this bowling ball just check right out of her hand. That looked farther right than she was playing last game.
Getting a chance to chat with Liz Johnson. She is one of the busiest professional bowlers on the planet. Liz bowls everything she can get her hands on. And this has been one of her busiest years, traveling to Germany and Denmark. A World Bowling Tour. Packs a pocket for a
better strike. Better shot. All right.
Hand was more up to bat. and better trajectory through the front part of the lane.
And then getting a chance to catch up with Kelly Kulick. It's always great to see Kelly. Warm, engaging person. She's just got such a great confidence in herself. And when she feels a sense of pressure and duty, she loves it because she likes to see if she can exceed expectations. Needs to strike to have this frame.
Come on, ball.
Yes. And the strike. And a halved frame. And Kulick maintains her one-up advantage.
Kelly going with a sinister, the strongest ball in her arsenal. Let's not forget, it wasn't that long ago when Kelly Kulick beat Chris Barnes, 2010 PBA Tournament of Champions here in Las Vegas, to become the only woman to ever capture a title, let alone a major.
Amazing accomplishment, as Kelly will have that moment forever. Six around the 10.
Good shot.
She's also a five-time major winner on the women's tour, including three U.S. Opens. Pretty good shot here. Great arm swing, hand behind it. Great posture at the foul line. Not a good result. Better shot than that. Liz Johnson now can even the match with a strike right here. This match will go back to all square after three frames.
Between second and third arrow, and a strike, and the match is all square.
Looked a little bit left of the last shot on that lane, and it finds that big slick of oil and just kind of straight line to the pocket. All square.
And we're on the 47-foot Paris pattern used on the World Bowling Tour. Johnson first crack in the fourth frame.
Push a little.
And a four pin, asking it to push a little. What's a bowler looking for, Randy, when they want it to push?
They're looking for it to hold its line so it has a chance to stay right of the head pin, or to scoot just a little bit longer before it starts to hook so they have a chance to hit the pocket.
Kulick now with a strike and get her advantage back to one up. Kulick delivers the strike, and she is one up in the match. Kimberly Pressler is with Sandra Andersson. Kimberly.
Thanks, Mike. Sandra, using this new point system, do you approach the game any differently?
Not really. I just try to take one shot at a time, as I normally do, so I didn't really think about it any differently.
How are the lanes transitioning out there?
It's different because we don't use any spare balls, but the transition happens really fast, so you got to stay. Yeah.
Do you like the new scoring or no?
I have to think about that one.
Thank you for your time, guys. Back to you in the booth.
Come on, ball. Tricky lane. Tricky lane.
Seven pin, the last to fall, as Kulick earns the strike. And a comeback not possible with the traditional scoring system, taken advantage by Liz Johnson to get to this championship match. Must strike now to stay one down.
She's familiar with this position, though. She was here last match.
And nice shot by Liz Johnson. And Kulick maintains a one-up position here in this championship match. Liz Johnson dropping strikes, and Kelly Kulick matching her, and who will stay ahead? More bowling coming from Vegas. World Bowling Tour Women's Finals presented by the PBA as we roll on here at the brand new South Point Bowling Plaza. Mike Jakubowski with Randy Peterson and Kimberly Pressler. Extra Frame, the PBA's online video subscription service, is gearing up for a big run of PBA tournaments over the next month. Featured live on Extra Frame will be coverage of four PBA Tour events, the PBA Players Championship, the Mark Roth Marshall Holman doubles in a pair of majors, the Masters, and the Barbasol PBA Tournament of Champions. Don't miss any of the action. Head to PBA.com and click on the Extra Frame link for more information. Women's final, Kelly Kulick one up. We're using the frame play, match play style system where you need to win the frame. Kelly Kulick is one up here in the sixth frame. And Liz Johnson trips the four and the seven.
It's a nice break, especially in this format. Strikes weighing so heavily in the scoring of this.
Now Kulick, who is one up, must strike to maintain that advantage. Anything less and we'd have an all square match.
You're getting really good at the math.
I'm good with ones. Beautiful shot, splitting the eight and the nine to maintain her one up advantage.
Yeah, just a world-class shot here when Kelly needed to and not let Liz even the matchup. She comes through with just a brilliant shot. She prides herself in being a shot maker. She practices working on being a shot maker.
Ball.
Light mixer bucket combo and just big. A two pin. Big nine count.
Big for the eight to fall late, Mike.
This left lane is brutal.
Eight turns into nine, and that's just a four pin or a flat 10 away from being a tie frame.
So Liz Johnson now can even up the match with a strike. That's a nine count.
And that's how big it was for the eight pin to fall late for Kelly Kulick.
And now.
Now we got to shoot spares.
Shoot spares for the first time in this competition. In the event that the count is the same, you must shoot the spares. So with spares from each, Kulick would maintain her advantage. So now Johnson must spare to have the frame.
Gotta be careful with this, using a plastic ball on this length of oil pattern, going cross lane at either a 10 pin or a 7 pin. Liz covers it nicely.
So the frame is halved. And Kulick maintains a one-up position heading into the eighth. High, 6-10.
Believe it or not, I did move. Believe it or not, I did move.
She just told her tour rep that she did make an adjustment. She moved, and that ball still went high.
Not Kulick. can go two up with nine or better. That's good enough. Kelly Kulick, two up. Using the frame play, match play style scoring system. Two up for Kulick through eight.
Two up, four to play. Kelly Kulick has the advantage now. I think the old pattern's broken down enough to where you have to create just a little bit of angle through the front part of the lane. I think that is an advantage for Kelly Kulick.
Kulick taking opportunities and advantages of the World Bowling Tour schedule, competing in Munich and Thailand and Vienna. She loves to travel. Enormous opportunity to visit and to compete at the world level. She's plus two, two up, ninth frame. Hexa strike.
Get this one.
Went one right with my feet. I untucked my pinky and just tried to.
Just told Del Ballard, Hall of Famer Del Ballard Jr., what move she just made. Liz Johnson, yeah, it's pretty much do or die time for her. Two down, four to play. She needs a strike here to have this frame. And you can see it coming now. That she's got that little trap where she has to make a big move and her angles have to change.
So Kulick now up three with three to play. Basically, Randy, Kelly Kulick now has three chances to shut out Liz Johnson.
Liz just made a ball change on this left lane as well.
Light, spun the seven. Nine count.
And you're right, you made a great point. She has three chances now to shut out Liz.
Here's the first.
Nine spare for both players here. The match is over. A strike here for Kelly Kulick. The match is over.
Considering tennis, it's like a match point. Sometimes you got one, two, or three of them. Kelly has three of them. Here's the first opportunity in the 10th to close out Liz Johnson and claim the World Bowling Tour Women's Final. For the win.
My ball, one time. Yeah.
Nope, it's not over yet.
Not over yet.
You gotta shoot your spares.
She goes first, right? So gotta make it.
Now spares will play a factor as Liz must make this to force Kulick to make it for the win.
Liz disappointed. She lost her reaction, and Liz was, you could see it. Liz saw the ball starting to hook early, and she needed to change angles. Kelly Kulick, she could just continue to just shimmy towards the middle part of the lane and slow roll it with a little bit of angle, and it's exactly what she did. A spare here wins it.
Focus was strikes. Now a spare gets the job done. Kelly Kulick.
Baby.
Is the World Bowling Tour Women's Champion.
Great home, kiddo.
I got it.
Great match.
Proud of you, honey.
Thank you, baby.
Proud of you.
Thank you so much. Yes. I love you.
Kelly Kulick, a 3-2 winner over Liz Johnson, claiming the championship in the women's division of the World Bowling Tour.
Thank you.
In a competition focused on strikes, this hammer tough spare replay clinches it for Kulick.
Won the match by converting a 10 pin, but it was really her ability to throw strikes throughout the match and Liz Johnson's inability to match them.
Coming up, the hottest rivalry in the PBA Tour with Sean Rash and Jason Belmonte. Congratulations to Kelly Kulick. We'll talk to her next. The GEICO World Series of Bowling World Bowling Tour Finals, presented by the PBA, is brought to you by GEICO, saving people money on more than just car insurance. By AMF, roll this way. By Barbasol, life is full of close shaves. Make sure your close shave is a Barbasol close shave. And by Hammer Bowling, nothing hits like a hammer. And the final score of the match with frame play, Kelly Kulick is the winner. And Kelly is laneside with Kimberly Pressler.
Thanks, Mike. Kelly, you said earlier that you really wanted to win back-to-back, and you have done this. So what does this moment mean to you?
This is such a huge accomplishment for my career. It extends my professional titles. It gives me more confidence going into the upcoming season with the new PWBA. And it just makes me want to travel the world even more, doing what I love, knowing that I have a chance to come back and do it all over again.
Well, enjoy this moment. Congratulations on your win.
And Randy, Kelly Kulick showing the great champion that she is. She can win in any format.
Yeah, I mean, Kelly's the real deal. She throws it so good. She's very committed, works hard at her craft, and she's very skillful. Knows what she's doing with her equipment. Kelly's the real thing.
And now looking at an ebonite flashback concerning you, my broadcast partner, Randy Peterson. One of the most memorable moments, and I know it rattles your spine every time, but you've come to peace with it.
Well, I just recently got out of therapy over this. This was back in 1995 or so, and I was Touring Players Championship. I'm going up against Ernie Schlegel. Ernie bowled a great game, and I bowled a great game. I don't think either one of us missed the pocket. Ernie needs a couple of strikes here in the 10th frame to lock me out, and he gets up and he leaves a massive ringing 10. Now, that gives me a chance.
What a great shot.
Ernie steps up, he covers the spare, and now it's my turn. I need a strike and six pins to win the Touring Players Championship. This is just outside of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania.
Strike is the big one.
And this is what I was left with. Obviously, I was a little distraught after that.
Unbelievable.
I mean, if you type in worst break in bowling history in YouTube, it's that video. And, you know, it was a tough thing to get over. But I'm over it.
It sounds like you're over it. I can't believe you made the spare.
I actually made the spare and struck on the fill shot to lose by one.
One of the most amazing and memorable moments in PBA history, and it's the subject of a new book about Ernie Schlegel, and the author is with us. Jean-Marc Manzione is the editor at Bowler's Journal magazine, and he is standing by right now with Kimberly Pressler.
Thanks, guys. So, Jean-Marc, that was a pretty crazy video that we just saw, and they were talking about up in the booth. And out of all the bad breaks in bowling that we've seen, how does this one rank?
Well, the last chapter of my book focuses entirely on that match. I call it the last great action match because of all the elements surrounding that bad break. You had two born entertainers in Ernie Schlegel and Randy Peterson competing before a sold-out arena crowd. You had a guy in Randy who had won from the top seed position six consecutive times before that match. You had Ernie Schlegel becoming the oldest player ever to win a major on the PBA Tour because of that Stone 8. But lastly, Kimberly, you had Randy Peterson showing people what a clutch performer he was throughout his career. He really threw a great shot in that moment.
Yes, he did. And thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Kimberly.
Well, those are very kind words, and thanks very much for that. Jean-Marc is a great guy. He's a very smart guy. He knows a lot about bowling. I need to get a copy of his book. More to come from South Point. When we come back, stay with us, folks. We got Jason Belmonte and Sean Rash. You don't want to miss this one.
The World Bowling Tour Men's Final Semifinal match set to begin. Jason Belmonte versus Sean Rash.
Well, the last time they met was the Super Clash in Detroit. A little three-game match that featured a lot of strikes by both players and lots of emotion. Two players that aren't real fond of one another, but throwing a lot of wood. Jason Belmonte would be your winner. Now let's go down to the floor with Kimberly Pressler.
Thanks, Randy. Sean, you and Jason are known to have a bit of a rivalry, but how does that affect your mental preparation coming into a match, if at all?
Nothing really. Jason, Mika, and myself have kind of separated ourselves from the rest of the field around the world the last couple years. Making great shots and filling frames is the reason why we're here today, and whoever does that right now is going to win.
Best of luck to you. Thank you. Thank you so much for your time. And Jason, the last time you and Sean went head-to-head was at the Super Clash, and you were victorious. But today you have something wrong with your right eye. What's the matter, and how is it going to affect your game?
Yeah, well, we know that Sean doesn't like me, so he poked me in my eye before we started this match. No, actually, something got in there yesterday. I don't know what it is. It's annoying the hell out of me. But I'm going to use my good eye for the most of the match, and hopefully I can still see the pins at the end of the day.
Well, good luck with that. Guys, back to you in the booth.
I thought that was pretty funny. What about you?
Nothing funny about this matchup. These two are serious. They've traveled the world. We've seen them battle in America. And now we get them right here in the semifinal of the World Bowling Tour men's final using the new frame play scoring system. Match play style competition where you need to win the frame. 12 frames of competition. And Sean Rash will open up the first frame of frame play. 32 out of Montgomery, Illinois. Six-time current member of Team USA.
And I think this scoring system benefits Sean more than it does Jason Belmonte.
Strike for Rash, and why do you feel that frame play might play to Rash's advantage?
Because historically at the World Series of Bowling, Sean has absolutely dominated all through qualifying and match play, but he gets to a television show, throws three or four or five great shots to start the match, gets a little ahead of himself, and one bad shot, one missed spare, seems to have cost him title after title. Well, in this format, one bad shot may not cost him the match.
Belmonte with a nine count. And Rash takes the first frame, so Rash one up. Belmonte crosses over, will begin frame two.
When you're talking about oil patterns, this 47-foot oil pattern favors Jason Belmonte. Historically, he's liked the longer patterns better than the shorter patterns. Sean Rash, he's bowled well on all the patterns. But I think longer is better for Jason.
Didn't like it, turned his head, nine count.
I got at least eight. Nine's good.
Nine was more than he expected to get after he let go of that one. Sean Rash can now take, can now go up 2-0 against Jason Belmonte here in the second frame.
Late.
And strike for Rash, so two frames. Two wins, two up for Sean Rash.
And even with all the power of Sean Rash and Jason Belmonte, you still see how straight the players have to play this 47-foot Paris oil pattern. Remember, the lane is only 60 feet in length. There's only 13 feet left of back of dry lane, if you will. And some of this oil has carried down past that 47-foot mark due to the practice balls that have gone down the lane. You can see that blue strip right there in the middle. Probably thinking to yourselves at home, well, why aren't the players playing outside of that? Seems like it would be drier out there. Well, it's not.
Lighter concentrations of oil outside the maximum concentration of oil in this pattern, and the three strikes in a row for Rash. And Belmonte must strike here to avoid going down three frames.
Yeah, trying to avoid going three down and
great shots.
Not sure how much of an effect that right eye has on Jason Belmonte. I have no idea what his vision is like right now.
Back into the pocket for the first time here.
And again, I think there's a lesson to be learned in watching these two power players and how straight through the front part of the lane they can play. You know, most people, I think, watching equate power players with players that all they can do is stand left and throw it to the right. And in order to compete at the highest level on this tour, you have to be able to do what these two are doing right now. There's going to be oil patterns that call for it, and you've got to be able to be versatile enough to go straight when you have to and open up the lane when you have to.
Powerful strike. Belmonte now lined up on each lane and puts Rash into a position to must strike, or he'll cut into the lead. Rash up two, must strike to maintain that lead. And there's the arsenal of Sean Rash. He's got the mastermind. The 10 indicates on a scale of 10 the maximum hook potential on this 47-foot Paris oil pattern 10-pin.
And, you know, that's what I was thinking. One flat 10 away for Jason Belmonte to pull to within one and only be one down after four frames. So easy to flat 10 on this oil pattern.
Here is the two-year rolling points list that determined who came to Las Vegas for today's WBT Finals. Less than 30 points separated Koivuniemi, Rash, and Belmonte, with 2013 PBA World Championship winner Dom Barrett just missing out.
Sean Rash did say he missed it at the bottom, that last shot when he left a flat 10. Jason Belmonte, I don't think it's possible for him to miss it at the bottom. Great shot. And the reason why I say that is because Jason doesn't use his thumb.
So Rash, strike on the board.
I need to move on the right. Move on the right.
Talking with Chuck Gardner, his tour rep is Sean. Now Jason Belmonte looking to stay just one down with a strike here in the fifth frame.
Lane's on fire.
Belmonte, seven counts. The lane is on fire for Jason Belmonte. And Sean Rash takes a two up lead. Rash, four out of five strikes, and a two up lead over Jason Belmonte. The rest of our semifinal match when we return to South Point Bowling Plaza. Semi-final match continues. World Bowling Tour Finals Men's Division presented by the PBA. And this Columbia 300 fun fact heading into this year's World Series of Bowling. Jason Belmonte has earned the most money in World Series of Bowling competition in the first 5 years. Belmonte has claimed three tour titles and earned over $200,000 in World Series events alone. And Jason Belmonte dealing with a sore right eye, and he's down two in this frame play match with Sean Rash. Sixth frame. Oh
my.
Great, solid nine.
It's a pretty good one.
Jason Belmonte leading the tour in just about every statistical category. He is first in earnings, first in average, and first in points. And right now he would like that. He'd like to see that nine pin not be there. Sean Rash can take the commanding three up lead with a strike right here.
A strike for Rash earns the frame. Sean Rash is the defending champion in these World Bowling Tour Finals, defeating Mike Fagan in last year's strike field edition. Rash captured the front seven and would prevail 255 to 231. The win came just 2 months after the birth of Sean and wife Sarah's first baby girl, Kaylee Isabel. Sean won that title next door in the South Point Convention Center. We've moved to the brand new South Point Bowling Plaza. Up 3-7th frame.
Lane.
Packs the pocket.
Got it in. The ball just froze.
Just, a heater, baby.
Just a straight frozen theater rope to the 1-3 pocket.
And Belmonte responds, evens, and halves the frame to maintain three down for the match. But Randy, frames are running out.
Five frames left, down three. Time running out for Jason Belmonte. He's in a must-strike situation now. I don't think he can miss the rest of the match and expect to have a chance.
Belmonte will get a fresh set of pins.
Liz Johnson was in this same position when she bowled
wrong line.
Sandra Andersson.
Belmonte, ESPY winner and former PBA Rookie of the Year, and in 2008 was crowned the World 10-Pin Bowler of the Year. This World Bowling Tour creating opportunities around the world, and Rash and Belmonte find themselves at the top of many leaderboards and many opportunities to face each other. And now Belmonte down three with five frames to play. He'll have the first shot in the 8th frame.
Well, good shot there. Now he's got to hope for a little help from Sean Rash. Rash hasn't missed the pocket yet. He left a 1-flat 10 in the 4th frame. Waiting for the pins to reset themselves on the right lane. Excuse me, on the left lane, rather.
So Rash must strike here to have the frame and maintain a 3-up advantage over Jason Belmonte. The winner will face Mika Koivuniemi, the top points leader in the 2-year rolling point system on the World Bowling Tour. Strike for Rash. He maintains a 3-up advantage with 4 to play.
Almost got it in that ring 10 zone, but the 6 still cooperated and took the 10 out. Again, look how straight through the front part of the lane that is for a power player. That's what makes these guys so good. This is what makes top professionals in our sport, being able to do this kind of stuff with a bowling ball.
Posted the shot and gets the strike.
Can't throw it that good.
Belmonte must strike here to have the frame.
If he doesn't strike here, the match is over.
And he gets the strike. He didn't like it, but the ball does come back and get the mixing strike. So Rash maintains a 3-up position with 3 to play.
Yeah, it looked like he lost his footing there, and a little fortunate that he did strike. He's taking another re-rack on the left lane.
Belmonte must win the frame. Rash has 3 opportunities to close him out. A half here would do the trick, meaning that Belmonte cannot shut out Rash on this frame. If Rash has the frame, the match is his. As we enter the 10th frame, 10th shot. So Belmo does what he can do, puts a strike on the board, forcing Rash to strike to win.
Rash.
Yeah, that was a good one.
Strikes, the match is over.
Ah. Sean Rash puts in the physical work and the mental preparation and the game plan, and now one strike will advance him to the championship match.
It's over. I mean, he really bowled a flawless game. He missed once. That's hard to beat.
Sean Rash with a 3-2 victory over Jason Belmonte, advancing to the championship match in the men's division of the World Bowling Tour. When we return to South Point Bowling Plaza, Sean Rash will face Mika Koivuniemi for the Men's World Bowling Tour Championship next. PBA World Series of Bowling 6 rolls on at South Point Bowling Plaza in Las Vegas. Time now for the PBA Bowling Challenge, offering a fan the chance to compete in a one-ball roll-off with a PBA Pro, with a chance to win that player's custom jersey, bowling ball, and a gift certificate. Fans were chosen through a social networking contest and must match or beat the pro's score to win. Any tie wins for our fan in today's PBA Bowling Challenge. Kimberly Pressler is with our fan.
Yes, I am, Mike, and it's 14-year-old Ryan Knippel from Las Vegas. Ryan, do you know who it is that you're going to be bowling against today?
No, I do not.
All right, well, why don't you turn around, because it's that guy right there, E.J. Tackett, reigning rookie of the year.
Awesome.
E.J., you going to take it easy on him?
No, you guys got to earn it.
All right. Well, we may have a little bit of a surprise here for you, because there's going to be somebody else bowling in this with you. So why don't you guys turn right around now? You see him right there. He's holding the ball. Do you know who that is? Is that Flavor Flav?
I think it is.
That is Flavor Flav, and he's coming over here, and he's going to be bowling with you guys. Look at this guy right here. Come on over, clock and all.
How you doing? God bless you. How you doing?
Thank you.
What's up, y'all?
So, Flavor, this is Ryan. That's EJ. You're going to be bowling against them. You like to bowl?
Yo, yeah, I like to bowl. And last night, I ain't going to lie, I got 171, 181. And today, everything is going to the right. So I don't know what kind of night, but it might be a little bit for me a fright.
I think either way, it's going to be good.
No, I'm going to have some fun.
All right, let's get to rolling.
EJ first.
It's myself.
13-year-old Ryan Knippel. Ryan, you got some flavor in your ear.
I can cross this off my bucket list, finally.
Right now?
The greatest day of my announcing career in my life.
What am I bowling on? Blue oil?
I never thought I'd ever have the opportunity to comment on E.J. Tackett and Flava Flav.
E.J. drills the pocket for a strike. One ball roll-off competition in the PBA Bowling Challenge.
All right, buddy, your turn. Your turn.
Now, 13-year-old Ryan Knippel out of Las Vegas will get his shot. He must match or beat the pro to earn EJ's jersey, bowling ball, and a gift certificate. On this shot,
needs to curve. That's all right. Ryan's used to bowling on a house shot.
You rock it.
That's all right. That's all right.
All right.
Oh,
all right, man.
All right.
Oh, you dropped one on me.
Right, listen. Blake. Listen, you got to just try to follow along, okay?
Randy P.
Now, I am rooting for Flavor Flav.
There's a racket.
Come on, baby. Come on.
Oh, 8 count for Flavor.
Good job, brother.
Hey, can I just say this?
Yeah,
he finished second.
I tried.
Yeah.
I got it down the middle, though, right? I got it down the middle, though. Not bad, not bad.
Hit the one in front, Flavor.
That was terrific.
More celebrity bowling next week is Nick Cannon, Terrell Owens, Jesse Williams, Chris Hardwick, and French Montana. Join host Chris Paul and some of the PBA's top pros for the CP3 PBA Celebrity Invitational next Sunday at 4:30 Eastern here on ESPN. Sean Rash defeated Jason Belmonte and will now face Major Mika Koivuniemi. The World Bowling Tour Finals Men's Championship match is next.
Welcome back, everybody, to South Point Bowling Plaza here in Las Vegas. The men's finals, the number one seed, Mika Koivuniemi, taking on Sean Rash. Folks, this isn't the first time these two have met at the WBT Finals. Back in 2011, Mika Koivuniemi took on Sean Rash. Nice carry there. Mika took home the title. The following year, Mika looking to defend, taking on tour roommate Chris Barnes. That ringing 10 would end up ultimately costing Mika the title. Let's send it down to the floor now with Kimberly.
Thanks, Randy. Mika, you have qualified for every single one of the finals for this event since its inception. How is it you continue to play at such a high level?
I don't know. I've been bowling probably most of the tournaments too, but it's 2 years rolling point list, and I always do well the year before, so it may force me to bowl next season again.
Well, good luck today, and thank you so much for your time. Guys, back to you in the booth.
Consistency, a hallmark of the career of a future Hall of Famer, Randy, in the Professional Bowlers Association. Mika Koivuniemi. And we are using the frame play, match play style scoring system. You must win frames. There's 12 of them in this match. Mika's 47. By way of Finland, now residing in Heartland, Michigan. And the Big Finn toes the line here in the first frame. Championship match. Perfect strike. 10 back for Mika.
Mika Koivuniemi in his 15th season as a pro, 13 career titles. Sean Rash in his ninth year, 8 titles. Mika's won in just about every continent, I believe. He's won just about everywhere.
Strike for Rash, and we have our first halved frame.
Take a look at the World Bowling Tour 2015 schedule. Start with the USBC Masters in Green Bay, Wisconsin. Qatar, Bahrain, some of these exotic places that these players get to travel to, Thailand. Looking forward to the summer swing again in Oklahoma.
Match is square, second frame, and Rash has a 9 count.
Looked like it was just a little fast. That's it, just a little faster. Just enough to create that ringing 10. 6 up and around the 10 pin and the react by Rash. He liked it, it was a good shot.
Speaking of Mika Koivuniemi on the World Bowling Tour, his last 4 PBA Tour titles have been of that variety, winning in Finland, Austria, Qatar, and Japan. Strike for the frame. And Mika Koivuniemi goes one up in this championship match.
Using 2 different bowling balls, and he stole one right here. I guarantee you Mika didn't like this one out of his hand. And he's like, oh no, please turn over, turn over. And it did, and ripped the rack. Mika one up after 2.
Mika Koivuniemi, the LX16 and the LX5. So a mix of balls in competition. And a strike. The LX5 in operation on the left lane. So Mika, strike, strike, strike through 3. Rash now must strike or he goes down 2 frames. A 3-2 winner over Jason Belmonte in match 1. And the frame is halved.
Good shot there. Mika going with two different bowling balls. Sean Rash using the same ball in both lanes, as did Jason Belmonte.
I got a re-rack. Please.
This ball crosses about 17 at the arrows, goes out to about 14, and then hooks back to about 17, 17 and a half.
Sean Rash has won on the World Bowling Tour with titles in Bangkok, Thailand, and the Kuwait International Open in Kuwait City, Kuwait. So Rash and Mika Koivuniemi, winners on the PBA Tour domestically in the U.S. and also compiling titles overseas. Sean Rath, first opportunity here in the fourth frame. He's down one. Mixing strike.
Let's see, today's Sunday. Sean Rash hasn't missed the pocket since Tuesday.
Nope.
And he agrees with you. Koivuniemi now in a must strike situation. He must strike here or the match is all square. Fourth frame. So Koivuniemi maintaining a one-up advantage as we enter the fifth frame.
Real good oil pattern for Mika Koivuniemi as well. He likes to keep everything in front of him. He's a master at getting his bowling ball to roll, read early, and stay online. Makes it look pretty easy, doesn't he?
He certainly does. I mean, it's the path. It's the path through the pins.
The thing that makes him so efficient is there's not a lot of moving parts. I mean, he just gets it into the top of the swing. His head doesn't move hardly at all. Just a nice short follow through. Not a lot of fancy stuff at the bottom of the swing. Pretty efficient game.
We see the 47-foot Paris oil pattern out there in blue. And Rash gets the six to kick the 10. So the frame is halved and Mika Koivuniemi, a five bagger, but just up one with five frames and seven opportunities to play. Men's division of the World Bowling Tour continues when we come back to South Point. The World Bowling Tour Men's Division Final rolls out at South Point Bowling Plaza in Las Vegas. Brand new facility. Sean Rash trails by one frame, and Kimberly Pressler is with Jason Belmonte.
Thanks, Mike. Jason, first off, how's the eye? It looks a little bit worse than it did about 30 minutes ago.
The eye's fine, honestly. I've got another one that worked quite well, so that's not the reason why I lost. He bowled a really good game. I think it was a legitimate 279. That's going to win you probably every game that you bowl on TV.
So do you think with this type of format, it makes it easier or harder to win?
Look, I think it's actually kind of gives you a little bit extra life coming down the back stretch in that particular match. If it was a traditional format, I think Sean probably would have locked me out well and truly before the final few frames. But in this particular format, you know, if I struck four times and he didn't, then, you know, I could have won the match in the dying minutes. So it's kind of, it kind of pushes you right to the end.
Well, thank you so much, and I hope the eye gets better soon.
Yeah, me too. Thanks, Kimberly.
Speaking, of course, of the frame play scoring, it's match play style. You must win the frame. And Koivuniemi, on the strength of a five-bagger, is one up. It's a 12-frame match. And Sean Rash will get the first shot in the sixth frame.
Mika struck every shot. Sean Rash left the one ring and 10 in the second frame, and that was it.
blisters the rack. Strike for Rash.
I got to tell you guys, the pocket is taking a beating right now. Sean Rash just throwing 10 back. Mika Koivuniemi, perfect. We're going to have to replace these pins.
Forces Mika to strike to keep his advantage. And a pin remains. It's a four pin, and this match is all square.
All even. You know, this is also going to come down to, besides the obvious, besides the player that makes the good shots, and it's also going to be the player that stays in front of the transitional move that the oil pattern is doing. I mean, when that oil pattern breaks down to where Mika just left the four pin on the right lane, if the player can anticipate that happening, make the move before he throws a shot, could win him a frame and ultimately the title.
All even, seventh frame. First shot belongs to Mika. And the 10 pin falls.
Like staying ahead of the transition. Making the adjustment with conviction. And then making the shot.
That is the name of the game. Sean Rash rolled the 23rd perfect game televised in PBA history. The PBA Summer Swing in 2014 at the Wolf Open on a 32-foot pattern. This one's 47. And Sean will reset.
He did it against Chris Loschetter. Then he beat Martin Larson the next game, 225-221. Then he beat Mike Fagan. And then he beat Chris Barnes for the title. It was his first title of the year and it's eighth of his career.
Rash needs a strike to have the frame.
Push.
That's a tight, tight line to the pocket. How many boards would you say that ball is deviating between laydown and when it hits the head pin?
Three.
Eighth frame. The match is all square. Title is not on the line here. It is a World Bowling Tour Men's Final Championship match.
Oh, God.
And it's an eight count.
That was not aggressive at all.
You heard him say it wasn't aggressive at all. It definitely was left of target.
And now Koivuniemi, just a nine count, will sew up the frame and give him that one frame advantage.
Last time on this lane, he went four pin. Not this time.
No doubter, strike for Koivuniemi, earning the frame and retaining his one frame advantage. One up now for Koivuniemi. Four frames remaining. Both of these players have thrown perfect games on television. Mika had the 16th in history at the 2003 Cambridge Credit Classic. Another great strike. That pendulum R swing, really in effect here.
A little high flush there. Look for Mika to make a small micro adjustment the next time he's on that left lane.
Rash must strike to have the frame, or he goes down two. And he rings a 10 pin.
Not a good time for a ringing 10. Two down, three frames to go.
Re-rack.
He's taking a re-rack on the left lane, buying some time. Not a good time for a ringing 10.
Rash must win the three remaining frames to earn the victory. In 12 frames of play.
All of a sudden, the angles now have caught up with Sean Rash, or have caught up with Sean Rash. He, you know, kept kind of migrating in, and that angle changes just enough as that ball's going through the pins to start leaving ring in 10 pins.
Tanaka Koivuniemi up to a strike will secure this championship. Seven count. Sean Rash is still alive. Sean earns the frame.
Big
wow turnaround.
Looked like he grabbed that one. That ball just didn't push down the lane and started hooking a couple of feet sooner than it had been. Watch this. Like he just got too much hand in this. That ball really checked and went through the face. Seven. He loses the frame. It is now only a one-up game. Two frames to play. Anything can happen, especially if Mika loses pocket. Sean at least is hitting the pocket.
11th frame. And the strike for Koivuniemi. Now an absolutely must-strike situation for Sean Rash.
Here's the thing. If Sean strikes here, he extends the match to the 12th frame. Mika has to go back to the right lane. Big shot here. This could win it for him. He goes strike here, strike on the left lane. Mika makes an adjustment. It doesn't work. It'll at least extend the match.
Oh, God. Never know.
He ties the frame, and let's take a look at our Barbasol close shave replay. Sean didn't like it off his hand. He flamed it right down the middle of the lane, and it just sat there in that oil. And he ties the 11th frame. Now, one frame. He's one down. One last chance for Sean Rash to extend this match. If he strikes here, Mika doesn't, we'll bowl an extra frame.
Coming down to the 12th.
Play.
And Sean Rash strikes in the 12th.
It's amazing how quick the turnaround is. No more ring and tens. The last couple of shots, Koivuniemi going back to the right lane where he went through the nose. He's going to take a re-rack. He's surveying the topography of this right lane, trying to figure out, okay, what is the move off of the last shot that he threw on this lane? If it was a good shot, he moves in, probably a two-in-one move, two boards left with his feet, one with his target, stays firm. If it was a bad shot, well, I guess you have to stay where you were when you were throwing strikes.
So Rash halves the 11th. He strikes in the 12th. He forces Koivuniemi.
He's taking a second re-rack. Out of re-racks now, you're only allowed two a game, or two for 12 frames. Big shot coming up here. Mika strikes, he wins.
Extra drama in the frame play scoring system. Rash halved it in the 11th, struck in the 12th. Mika must strike to win the match. Anything less and we'll go to bonus frames. World Bowling Tour men's final championship match. This championship is on the line. Mika can earn it right here with a strike. The 4-9 for the win.
Let's go.
Mika Koivuniemi, World Bowling Tour men's champion in a one-up thriller, Randy, all the way to the end.
Chip 4-9. What a brilliant break for the match and for the win. Coming off of a shot that went right through the face the last time he was on the right lane. Mika steps up, throws another really good shot. He thinks it's high flush. It's just a pinch high. He's like, oh, hey, wait a minute. Oh, trip 4-9 winner.
And a razor-thin margin for Mika Koivuniemi, World Bowling Tour men's champion. Kimberly Pressler will have a chat with our new champion once we return back to South Point in Las Vegas. The GEICO World Series of Bowling World Bowling Tour Finals, presented by the PBA, is brought to you by GEICO, saving people money on more than just car insurance. By AMF, roll this way. By the USBC, the national governing body servicing the needs of bowling. To learn more, visit us on bowl.com. And by Barbasol. Life is full of close shaves. Make sure your close shave is a Barbasol close shave. The World Bowling Tour men's final, the champion Mika Koivuniemi earning a one-up victory in an exciting match over Sean Rash. Time now for the GEICO Championship recap. Randy.
In the women's semifinals, Sandra Andersson, Liz Johnson matchup. Liz Johnson throws a shot there to extend the match. Then Liz in the 13th frame gets up, throws 10 back. Sandra needs all 10 or she loses. Good looking shot, just right until it tips a little too much, leaving the four pin. Liz Johnson advances to take on Kelly Kulick. And in the women's finals, it was all Kelly Kulick. Shot there in the ninth frame to go to a three up lead. Liz Johnson, right through the face, gets seven. Kelly Kulick just needs to convert a 10-pin to win. Yes, she does it easily. She is your WBT Women's Finals champion. The men's semifinal match number one, Sean Rash taking on Jason Belmonte. And it was the Sean Rash strike fest. Starts out with a front three, leaves a 10-pin, and never stops striking. He takes Belmo down with a three-up win. Then the finals were set. Mika Koivuniemi, Sean Rash. Ninth frame for Rash. He gets nine. Mika goes through the nose and gets seven. Cuts his lead to only one up. Mika then steps up in the 11th frame. Kicks the 10 out. Sean Rash has to match or the match is over. He doesn't like it, but it ends up in a perfect spot. We go to the 12th frame. Sean Rash needs to put pressure on Mika Koivuniemi. He says lay and all 10 lay. Now Mika, the stage is set. He needs all 10 to win. How about a little trip 4-9 for my second WBT title? Let's go down to the floor with an interview with Kimberly Pressler.
Thanks, guys. Mika, this is the second time that you have won the World Bowling Tour Men's Championship. Describe what this win means to you.
This means a lot. You have to bowl whole year or 2 years good to get here to bowl for this title. And bowling against Sean, tough match, different scoring system, same result than last time, so I'm happy.
Congratulations on your win.
Randy, just another in a bunch of milestones in Mika Koivuniemi's great career.
Well, you know, I think Mika is kind of like the forgotten player out here. You know, everybody talks about Sean Rash, Jason Belmonte, all of the power players. And then there's Mika, who just kind of unassumingly gets it done. You know, he made a great point in that he had to bowl well for 2 years to earn that top seed. And then he takes full advantage of it. The new modified scoring system didn't affect him at all. And once again, he beats Sean Rash for a WBT title. Mika had a real nice World Series of Bowling. He did capture the Viper Championship. He captures this event. I think it's probably a little too early to forget about 47-year-old Mika Koivuniemi.
Coming up next Sunday on ESPN, it's the Chris Paul PBA Celebrity Invitational next Sunday, 4:30 Eastern, presented by AMF. Geico PBA World Series of Bowling 6, many great champions crowned here. For Andy Peterson and Kimberly Pressler, this is Mike Jakubowski. So long from Las Vegas.